Good afternoon, everybody. I feel honored and also my colleagues to be able to present our report in this opening of the academic year at Stendon University. And we would like to thank the executive board of Stendon University for the invitation, not only for writing the report, but also for presenting it here. We, of course, are aware that the reasons behind this invitation were critical signals in Dutch media and politics on the handling of Stendon's internationalization policy and its four branch campuses in Qatar, South Africa, Indonesia, and Thailand. I have to confess that we all three also, before taking up the assignment, had our question marks and were not at forehand convinced that the approach to internationalization of Stendon was the most adequate one. Notwithstanding, we appreciate that the executive board of Stendon invited us and allowed us to do our work in complete freedom and openness. In our three presentations, we will highlight some of our major findings and recommendations and place them in the context of national and global developments in international higher education. This context and the intensive and open debate with the different stakeholders of Stendon University have provided us a more realistic and positive picture on the evolution of the internationalization policy of Stendon and its international operations. At the same time, we provide in our report several suggestions for its further enhancement. In this way, we hope to confirm the well-known adagium of our famous soccer player Johan Cruyff, "Elk nadeel heeft zijn voordeel." Every disadvantage creates an advantage. Let me briefly present the global and national context. Over the past 40 years, internationalization of higher education in the Netherlands and also in most of the global arena has taken several forms and actions. Internationalization in many countries, and in particular in our own country, in the 70s and early 80s of the past century, was primarily focused on development cooperation and aid. Support to universities in developing countries by providing scholarships, equipment, and advice. In the second half of the 80s, internationalization took a different direction in different parts of the world. In most of continental Europe, thanks to the development of scholarships programs and mobility schemes, in particular the well-known Erasmus program, the emphasis focused on the exchange of students and teachers as well as joint curriculum development. Since these programs started, over 2 million students and thousands of teachers have used them to spend a semester or a year at another European university. That was the case in the European continent, but in countries like, for instance, and in particular the United Kingdom and Australia, the emphasis around that time shifted for more from what we call aid to trade. Instead of providing scholarships for students from developing countries, universities were forced by their governments to charge full cost fees to international students, using as an argument, why should our taxpayers have to pay for the education of these foreign students? And interesting enough, against all expectations, they did not result in a decrease of international students coming to these countries, but in a substantial increase. Following probably the parents and the students, the principle, what you have to pay for much must be of good value. And it made the United Kingdom the number two and Australia the number five country in receiving international students who would then pursue their full degree, after the United States being number one and Germany and France being close to the other two. In the 90s of the past century, influenced among other by the Asian economic crisis, as most of the students who went to Australia and still go and to the United Kingdom came from those countries, Australia and the United Kingdom took the lead to a new direction of internationalization, referred to as well as transnational education, cross-border delivery of education, or offshore education. The underlying argument was, if they don't come to us, why do we not go to them? Their universities developed branch campuses and franchise operations in countries like Singapore, Malaysia, Vietnam, South Africa, and so on. It was a shift in movement from students to the movement of programs and universities, which, by the way, didn't stop also the movement of students going abroad. Together with the United States, Australia and the United Kingdom are now the leading nations in international higher education by the inflow of international students and by the offshore activities. Already more than a third of the international students studying at British and Australian universities are not studying in those countries but in their offshore operations. This shift in internationalization in the 1990s and further developed in the past decade is referred to in many articles as a shift in paradigm from cooperation to competition, a more commercial approach to international higher education. In continental Europe, including the Netherlands, this more commercial approach was originally watched with rather negative eyes. Free or low tuition fee based higher education was and still is more common here. And that applied until recently also to students coming from outside the European Union. It is in this global context that we have to place the initiatives of Stendon to recruit international students and to develop its international branch campuses. In that, the universities around 10 years ago followed more the British and Australian approach to internationalization, in particular in its development of offshore activities, than most of the continental European way of looking at internationalization was. That these activities were, and to a certain extent still are, more perceived as commercial activities than academic ones, has been inspired by those developments in Australia and the United Kingdom, but also by the fact that there was no framework in the Netherlands other than to take private initiatives to be involved in this kind of international operations. Interestingly, we see in the past few years, also in continental Europe and the Netherlands, a move to full cost fees for international students. From outside of the European Union, Denmark, Sweden, the Netherlands have followed the British example of 30 years ago. But if one follows the Dutch media in the past weeks, also an increasing pressure for dealing with the cost of for the Dutch taxpayer of the increased inflow of students from the European Union, in particular from Germany, where most international students come from, including here at Stendon. And as a consequence also, recently this year, of the much higher tuition fees in the United Kingdom, also from that country we see this inflow increasing. In the media, this is in general seen as a Dutch problem, but that's not the case. It's also a problem in smaller countries, neighboring countries like Austria, Belgium, and it has become even a major problem recently in Scotland, where the tuition fee in contradiction to England is free, and they face now a massive inflow from students from the United Kingdom, much more than the few students that come to, for instance, Groningen or Maastricht. And this results in a remarkable and already by the British labeled as racist plan by Scottish universities to charge high fees of £9,000 only to British students. A plan which probably is not very realistic, but still it explains the seriousness of the problem that they face. In addition to these development and internationalization, last but not least, we also see a shift in geographical sense. The traditional divide between north and south and east and west of the past century is not longer to be taken for granted. The increasing importance of Asia, the developments in the Middle East, Latin America and Africa change also the higher education landscape and by that its international dimension. They bring in new values, new approaches, and new needs of relationships. I provide this context as to indicate that the internationalization policy is developed, as developed by Stendon in the past decade, with a strong focus on international student recruitment and its international branch campuses, might have been seen as unique and at odds in the Dutch and even continental European situation, but not so much within the wider global context. And continental Europe is increasingly following the examples elsewhere by opening branch campuses, for instance, by German universities, Belgian universities, French universities, and so on. While the Netherlands lags behind, an issue that will be explained more in detail by Frans Swartz later in his presentation. Recently, though, we also see in countries like Australia and the United Kingdom a reaction which has taken place on the strong commercial focus in its international education. Was in the 1990s their main interest, we are only in it for the money, as to paraphrase the American pop musician and composer Frank Zappa, now the higher education sector in these countries has understood that such a pure commercial approach will jeopardize the quality of their education, the reputation of the institutions, and by that, the future inflow of national and international students. This implies that we see in those countries more selection on international students, accreditation and quality control of their offshore operations, transfer of revenues to better facilitate, counsel, and guide the international students, and more emphasis on the internationalization of the curriculum and on study abroad of their own students. By the way, Australian and British students are not very well known to be very mobile, so that's a very important dimension for them. So we see a new shift in internationalization, a move to mainstream internationalization within the overall quality of education, and a move to a more comprehensive approach and less revenue-based. This is also the shift that the expert team has noticed in the internationalization policy of Stendon over the past 5 years. The 4 international branch campuses are becoming much more an integrated part of the internationalization policy of Stendon, and together a global Stendon community is emerging. Stendon's internationalization policy is composed on 3 related elements. First, internationalization at home, the internationalization of the curriculum and the teaching and learning. Secondly, international faculty and student mobility, in particular the Grand Tour. And thirdly, program mobility, as referred to the 4 international branch campuses. Let me briefly address these 3 components and our findings with respect to them. Internationalization at home. According to my colleague Jos Beelen, and I quote, internationalization at home has a comprehensive scope in that it addresses all students and not just the mobile minority, that it encompasses both the formal and informal curriculum as well as services. The overall aim of internationalization at home is that all students leave the university as professionals who are competent to work and live in a globalized world. End of quote. For Stendon, this focus on internationalization at home implies the offer of international study and living climate at its locations in the Netherlands and abroad. The important pedagogical method of problem-based learning is coupled with the presence of a substantial proportion of international students who are spread out as much as possible within the PBL groups. And this creates an international learning environment in which particular attention can be given to the international dimension of teaching and learning, intercultural components of the curriculum, and education in the foreign language. It's the view of the expert team that this focus on internationalization at home is the correct approach, but we also recommend further fine-tuning of that approach and stronger links with the other 2 components than at present is the case. Let me look at the second component, international mobility, the Grand Tour, faculty mobility, and international students. In the documents of Stendon, with respect to international mobility, the main focus is on what is called the Grand Tour, the mobility of students of Stendon University to the international branch campuses as part of their home degrees. Over the past 25 years, international mobility of students as part of their home degree has been a key factor in both institutional, national, and European policies of internationalization. In particular, European programs such as Erasmus have given an enormous impetus to study abroad within Europe and also had an impact on stimulating study abroad to the rest of the world. The European ministers of education in 2009 agreed to set a target of 20% of all students, and the Dutch Minister of Education In 2008 set an even higher target of 25% of the students having to study abroad. Whether these targets in general are realistic remains to be seen, but Standen sees international mobility of its students clearly as an important component of its internationalization policy. And the Grand Tour is in that a very important dimension. This Grand Tour has more similarities to the concept of study abroad as it is practiced in universities in the United States. Concentrated summer, semester or year abroad programs for students from the same institution or a consortium of institutions who spend their period abroad under the supervision of faculty from their home campus and as a recognized part of their home degree. This model of study abroad is less common in Europe, and in particular uncommon in the Netherlands, where a more individual approach to study abroad is seen. Students who, although based on bilateral agreements with institutions, go on an individual mode to study at another university in Europe for a semester or a year, and for which they receive credits at their home degree. This individual approach is also the rationale behind, for instance, the Erasmus program. So in that sense, the Grand Tour is a very unique concept in the European context. While Standen students can still opt to go on the regular exchange programs, including Erasmus, and Standen has 200 partners, twice as many students choose to go on the so-called Grand Tour program, in which they undertake a study load of maximum of 30 credits at one of the four branch campuses. In 2010, about 380 students participated in the Grand Tour, and for 2011, nearly 500 are expected to take part. These numbers reveal the growing popularity of this option over the past years in comparison to the more traditional exchange programs. Together with those exchange programs and internship opportunities abroad, Standen is, in particular thanks to the Grand Tour, more likely to reach the European and national targets of 20 and 25% than most other European institutions of higher education. We, as an expert team, recommend, therefore, that Standen continue in its efforts to expand the Grand Tour as an instrument to enhance the international experience of the students and as an integral part of its internationalization policy. But we also make some suggestions for further improvement of the Grand Tour. We recommend, for instance, that Standen gives more attention to the preparation of the students for participation in the Grand Tour. We recommend to improve the pre-departure orientation for Grand Tour participants. We recommend also an effort to include more branch campus students in the Grand Tour, not only having students from Leeuwarden going to the four campuses, but also between the four campuses. We have observed that there is an insufficient mobility of Standen faculty and staff to the various branch campuses. By the same token, faculty and staff from the various branch campuses should have an opportunity to visit, teach, or work at the home campus in Leeuwarden, even only for short periods of time. Also, we make an appeal to have more interaction between faculty and senior administrators of the different branch campuses. We have noticed that little sharing of experience between the branch campuses and Leeuwarden and between the three of them themselves, the four of them themselves, is taking place on common issues such as human resource policies, Grand Tour administration, marketing and recruitment, community development, and internship policies. The last point of international mobility is the international students. The international students at Standen comprise 22% of total enrollment, making Standen the most international institution in the Netherlands among the comprehensive universities of applied sciences. We've noticed an overrepresentation, which is not unique for Standen, of German and to a lesser extent Chinese students among those international students, and we recommend that this will be much more diverse. International students are clearly an important aspect of the international profile of the university and should be an integral part of its internationalization policy. Their presence contributes to the internationalization at home and also to the multicultural composition atmosphere at the campuses. The last but not least important component of the internationalization and policy of Stenden is the international branch campuses. For Stenden, they are an essential element for the full realization of its internationalization policy. Indeed, they are seen by many in Stenden to be the driving force behind this internationalization strategy. They strongly contribute, in their opinion, to the internationalization of students, faculty and staff, and provide an important venue for student learning, both in the classroom setting and the local community. It is our impression that the internationalization policy university and the development of the branch campus in that is strongly supported at the campus by students and by faculty and by administrative staff. Nevertheless, there are some faculty members who are still skeptical of the motivation for this policy, as also is the case, unfortunately, in the broader higher education community in the Netherlands. However, it appears that this is mainly due to a lack of understanding of the transition in the focus of internationalization and the role of the branch campuses from a more commercial to an integrated educational approach that has taken place over the past years. We also have observed that substantive steps are being taken to enhance the coordination, integration and division of responsibilities between Stenden Netherlands and the four branch campuses, although there is still more to be done. The branch campuses have developed into an important and integral part of the internationalization policy of the university. And by that, they provide the opportunity of mobility for the students and staff of Stenden, while at the same time they enrich the international profile of the institution and help build an international Stenden community of teachers, administrators and students. Ultimately, the campuses greatly enhance internationalization at home. At the same time, the branch campuses have to operate as private joint venture institutions of higher education, which by definition means that they have to be economically viable or they will not be sustainable in the long run. The current student enrollment and number of degree programs offered by the four campuses, in our opinion, are not strong enough at the moment to ensure the sustainability. This is particularly true in the case of the campuses in Bangkok and Bali, which enroll a very small number of degree students and are predominantly dominated by surfing grand tour students. We recommend that before considering plans for the development of new campuses, priority should be given to the further enhancement, strengthening and consolidation of the current four campuses with Stenden Leeuwarden. To conclude, summarizing our opinions about the internationalization policy of Stenden, we think that there is a clear and definite relationship between two components of its internationalization policy: international mobility of students, in particular the Grand Tour, and international programs, in particular the branch campuses. At the same time, the other two elements of the policy, internationalization at home and international mobility of faculty and staff, can be strengthened and better integrated with the first two. In this way, Stenden's internationalization policy evolves in line with the development elsewhere, as described before, moving away from a more commercial to a more integrated, comprehensive educational approach to internationalization, focused on enhancing the quality of the teaching and learning offered and the preparation of the students for a profession that requires more international and intercultural competencies. The initiatives taken over the past years and the vision and mission of its current leadership gives us the confidence that the evolution will continue. I will hand over now to my colleague Stephen Dunnett of the University of Buffalo to place Stenden's internationalization policy and its international operations in an American perspective. Thank you very much.